right after I got back to, and I was reassigned when I got back to the States to El Toro, California, the 1st Marine Air Wing. Right after I got home, I was up for major, so I got promoted to major. And that's what I had when I finally got out when I resigned. In that regard, it would kind of lead into my next career. And I got back from Da Nang, and I had been, before that, I'd been at Pensacola for 3 years, assigned to the Navy, and then over there, I had nothing but a desk job in the headquarters of the commander. So I have to have a squadron when I get back to El Toro. And didn't happen. They assigned me back because I'd had so much experience loading ships and people in Da Nang that they sent me to embarkation school and made me the wing headquarters for all the squadrons that were leaving and sending people back and forth and equipment. Another desk job. Just hated it, but had some good people working for me, and we got everything done we needed to do every time, with inspections and all that sort of stuff. And so I finally decided I've had enough of this. They're not going to get me in where I want to be, and I'm getting senior. I'm a major now, so I went into the CO and I said, I'm going to get out. I'm going to resign and go back to civilian life. That guy's name, Colonel Rock. Nice guy. He says, "What are you going to do?" And I said, "Well, I'm going to apply to the airlines and see if I can get a job with an airline." Which I had already done, actually. I had already taken the test for United, and I had letters out to every airline in the country. So he said, "Well, I got a good friend of mine that is a chief pilot for Frontier Airlines." And I said, "I don't know Frontier." He says, "Well, it's kind of a small airline. They're based in Denver, Colorado. This guy and I were old fraternity brothers, and he's a chief pilot at the Frontier." So I said, "Well, I'll give him a call and you can talk to him and interview over the phone or something." I said, "Yeah, just right out of the blue." And of course, airline pilots, are always gone on a trip or back. Turns out that Army Armstrong was his name, and Colonel called him up, and he was home. He said, "I've got some major jarhead here that wants to go to the airlines." And he said, "Why don't you talk to him about it?" So he said, "Okay." And he handed me the phone, and I'm talking to this guy, and his name was Army Armstrong. And that's what he was. He was big, giant of a guy. And he said, "Hell yes, come on over to Denver, and we'll do an interview and do some tests." And he says, "We're going to start hiring people, as a matter of fact, because we just bought another airline down in Texas. And it was called Central Airlines, and they bought it and made it into Frontier." So that's how it happened. I got back, and I left the family in El Toro. They didn't have any place in Denver to live, and I didn't know where I'd be going. So I got over there and did the exams and did some ground school and got all set up. They hired me and got me set up with the uniform and everything for the airline as a co-pilot, and I was a captain, certainly. That's where you start out at the bottom, but again. Eventually we finished up, and they sent my whole class, there was 8 of us in class at the time, and they sent us all to Texas, to Fort Worth, Texas, which is where they bought this new airline, so they were merging everything together, so all of us new hires got sent to Fort Worth, Texas. So I hustled around and found a little small house and put a down payment on it, and then I went out to California and picked up Jane and all the kids. We had bought a little travel trailer out at El Toro when we were stationed there and did some traveling out there, sightseeing and camping out. So we loaded up the trailer and off we went for Texas. Had a little adventure there, as a matter of fact, where I think I was somewhere east of Albuquerque, New Mexico, or way out in the boonies. And I lost all my hydraulics, the pump, the lines blew on the power steering and the brakes and everything. And middle of the night, it was, God, it must have been 2 o'clock in the morning or something. And I managed to struggle it over and get it off on the side of the road. And I'm pulling this big trailer. Wasn't a really big one, but so I raised the hood on the car to see what was wrong, and the air mixing with the fuel and the oil that was spilled all over the engine had a flash fire, big flames coming out of it. I ran back to the trailer, opened it up, and got a fire extinguisher we had in there, and ran back to the, and by that then the engine, it had burned off all the oil and hydraulics, and so the fire was out, but I was spraying everything with fire extinguisher. And so I went back and put the fire extinguisher back in the trailer. And when the fire happened, I said, let's get everybody out of the car. I didn't know how bad it would get. So Jane was pulling kids out of the back. They were all in the back sleeping on the floor. And so we had everybody standing around on the side of the road. And I said, okay, we got it out. And I put the fire extinguisher back and got the car started, and it was just manual steering, but you could, it was usable. It was hard driving, but it was okay. And so we started down the road, and and we were about maybe not 50 yards down the road, and I heard this little voice screaming, "Daddy, Daddy, Daddy!" And I, the first thing went through my mind, I thought, "Oh, one of the kids is running down the highway trying to catch us." And I stopped the car, and I opened the door, went back. And Eileen was in the trailer. She had crawled in there when everybody got out of the car. She crawled in and fell back asleep, I guess. And anyway, she was had the door open, was hanging out the door screaming, "Daddy." And oh my God, it could have been so much horrible. I mean, she could have fallen out, or we could have. Anyway, I, of course, picked her up and hugged her and locked the door again and brought her back to the car. And everybody was pretty excited about that, especially Eileen. She was crying for hours. And that's about it. We finally got to Texas and in our little house I had bought, and set up housekeeping and actually went to Arlington, Texas, which was a suburb of Fort Worth. And that's where we started our airline career. And the first flying was a DC-3, which is a horrible airplane. It, about 55 years old, a twin-engine prop, and it only held 20 people, and the navigation gear was ancient. Everything was ancient on the thing. It was tough landing, too, because it was a tailwheel landing. It didn't have the nose wheel. The nose wheel airplanes, you can see where you're all the way down to touchdown, and with a tailwheel, as you get slow enough, you have to raise the nose to get the tail down. And they're tougher to land, a lot tougher. So anyway, I got assigned to the DC-3, and I flew that for, I think, almost a year. Then I had I moved up in the chain of command to where I could get a flight with a Convair 580, which was a beautiful airplane. Big, it was only a twin engine, but it was a turboprop. It had turbine engines that drove the propeller, and the props were huge, big steel props, and you could go into full reverse and stop the airplane with them. Anyway, it was a 50-seat airplane, and it did a lot of the middle America small airports, tiny little places like Scotts Bluff, Nebraska, and Hayes, Kansas. And so the only problem with that is that the hops were so close together, the cities, and what we were doing mainly was carrying the mail. You might carry 10 people once in a while, or maybe 20, but we carried the mail, air mail, and geez, you'd go from one city to the next, it would only be a 20-minute flight, maybe 30 minutes. So you're taking off and landing. And we had some of our trips where we actually had 14 landings in one day, from one city to city to city, all the way across the country, over from Denver all the way to Kansas City. And eventually we started flying all the way to Atlanta, and stops everywhere. That was pretty tough. And the airplane didn't have an autopilot on it. So you hand flew it all the time. You were flying it with, of course, you were only in the air 20 minutes or so, but, you know, the takeoffs and landings. And but it was a lot better than that DC-3. And, well, one of my adventures in the Convair 580 was I finally moved from co-pilot to captain. I got checked out as captain. And they sent me to Kansas City for my base. So I was flying there, and they had a airplane in St. Louis that had broken down. I don't know what was wrong with it. It had an engine problem or something. And they wanted to finish the guy's trip. So they sent an empty airplane over there for him to take off. And I was the captain. They said, you fly this. And just, of course, you have a pilot, a co-pilot, and a one flight attendant. The 580 only had one flight attendant all the while. She serviced 50 people. And so we had an empty airplane going from Denver to Kansas City. I mean, from Kansas City to St. Louis. And it had been, oh, miserable winter weather. It was snowing and ice and everything. And the runway at St. Louis was completely cleared off and clean. It was snowing like heck when I landed. And when we got slowed up and turned off on a taxiway to go to the ramp to deliver the airplane, the rain had been raining and it had worn out some of the ice into little puddles. And there was one, actually they hadn't cleaned the taxiway, which was wrong. And it, when you turned off the runway, you actually went up on a step of ice that was about 4 or 5 inches high. And you're riding on ice the rest of the way into the terminal. And as it happened, one of the rain had eroded a big puddle of the ice. When I came up to that hole, I didn't know it was water. It was water everywhere. Well, it was pretty deep, and it snapped the nose wheel right off the airplane. Not off of it, but snapped it back into the fuselage. And of course, the airplane went down on its nose, and I had one engine shut down for getting out. That's the way you always did that when you stopped and landed, shut one down. The other one was running at high speed, and when those props hit the ground, they just started ripping everything apart and just parts flying all over the place. I'm skidding along on my nose, and one of the blades broke loose from the engine and embedded itself right in the fuselage of the airplane. It's sticking in there by 5 feet or so, right behind the cockpit. Oh, I climbed out of that. I got the door open and climbed out. It was still raining and I was on a sheet of ice. I fell on my butt right away in my uniform. I went down and backed up and looked at that hole. And of course they had crash trucks coming out and everything, and the car picked me up, took me into operations. And I said, before anything happens, I want somebody to go out there with a tape measure and measure the depth of that hole. And this was St. Louis's fault to have all that stuff on the taxiway anyway. So they did that and they took pictures of it, and we got a pretty dynamic picture of the plane with a prop blade sticking in it. And of course they exonerated me, it wasn't my fault, but I was a brand new captain and I thought, oh geez. Well, as a matter of fact, because of that crash at St. Louis, Frontier Airlines sued Lambert Field in St. Louis for $568,000, and they rebuilt the whole airplane for us and sent it back. So it was adjudged to be totally their fault. And that was kind of the exciting part of my first part of my being a captain with the airline. Oh. That's when I was at the Frontier as a pilot, and it was Halloween. And so the co-pilot and I went in the store and got these gross masks, rubber masks. And on our final landing, I think it was in Kansas City, as a matter of fact, we opened the door and I took my coat and I put it on backwards and stumbled out of the cockpit with this Frankenstein face on, and the co-pilot was a ghost or something, and the people just howled crazy. Yeah, that was a fun Halloween flight. Yeah, when I was in the reserves, flying with the airlines and flying with the reserves in Dallas, and we lived in Arlington, Texas, and we had a nice four-bedroom home there with a dead-end street where we were right across from the Catholic church and school, and the kids went to school there, and it had a big football field. Well, it wasn't football. It was just a big lot that they owned. They didn't have football in grade school, of course, but behind us was the University of Texas Arlington, UTA, and they had a big football field. It was right behind our house across the alley. So I could pick it out real easy from altitude. And one day I had just a fly and hop for fun and putting in time so I get my pay. And I went across the house. I went down over the University of Texas football field at real low altitude, just about rooftop level. And the kids were all out playing. So I wanted to get their attention, so I just went over and came back around. And after I came around the second time, as I went over the house, I pulled the airplane straight up, lit the afterburner, and rolled up into the air to 20,000 feet. And all the kids were down in the airport watching me. Mike was so excited. All of them were. One of my neighbors was a little, he thought I blew shingles off his roof. I didn't do that anymore. That was, you get caught doing that, you get in some big trouble. Oh well, raising eight kids was a lifetime in itself. They were good kids. They didn't do anything bad, but they were always ornery and getting in trouble here and there. When we were in California, we went to Disneyland and Knott's Berry Farm with all the kids. And as we were walking along from one venue to the other, Eileen, as usual, found a place where she was having such a good time. She just stayed there, was watching an artist. And sometime later, we both, Jane and I, turned around and started counting. And we were shy one, oh, it's Eileen. And so we went to the security desk. They had a security building there. And she was eating ice cream with the policeman, having a good time. Scared us to death, you know, in a place like Knott's Berry Farm where there's 10,000 people all over the place. And, well, let's see. This is a little funny adventure with Mike and Jim. Neighborhood boys, we were right at the end of the street on a cul-de-sac, and that's where we always gathered and played, throwing footballs, so forth. And I was sitting in the house in my study, and I saw some lights in a fire engine out in front of the house with the lights going around and around. So I walk out there, and in the meantime, Jim and Mike had beat it back into the house, and the fire engine were putting out a fire out in the middle of the cul-de-sac. And they said, "What in the hell went on here?" And I said, "I don't know, but I'm going to find out." So they put it out and took off, and I go back in the house, and Mike and Jim are in the downstairs bathroom, and Mike is in severe pain. What they had done is they decided to play Viking soccer. They lit a tennis ball with gasoline and were kicking it around in between when it's on fire. And at one point or other, they hit the can of gas and it went over and the whole thing lit up. And Mike was trying to stomp it out with his feet, and he had on nylon socks, and they just melted right into his skin. And he was in the bathroom. He wasn't screaming or anything, but there was just horrible raw skin all the way down on his ankles and both legs. So went off to the hospital, raced off to that, and he was sore for a long while. They put him in a hot tub to debride the skin on his legs. And I got in there and I says, "I don't want to hear one tear out of you." and it must have hurt like hell. He just gritted it, and then of course he went to bandage up and had to go back and forth to the doctor, and it eventually healed. He still got a lot of scars on his ankles from that one. And they we had a big fence behind our house, and as I said, there was an alley, and then the university football team, they had a purse, one of Jane's purses. He put it on a rope and took it out and laid it in the street and went back under the fence, and we're peeking out through the fence to see, and a car would stop and go to pick up the purse, and then they'd yank it back out clear across the street. The guy just get back in his car and everything. And so one of the cars happened to be a police car, and they pulled it on him, and they came knocking on the front door. Automobile wrecks, we had a couple of those. Peggy was the first one. Or no, yes, it was Peggy. She was driving our family car, the 9-passenger Plymouth station wagon. And I don't know where she was going, but she was going through an intersection putting on her makeup and putting on lipstick or something. And a guy who had the right of way and just T-boned her right in the side with the Plymouth. His car and our car wreck. And of course we had to do the insurance thing with that. And I think they fixed that up, and we still kept that Plymouth for a long while. When they were just toddlers, in fact, wearing diapers, I'd have them walk out on the low diving board and jump in the water to me, and I'd catch them, and we'd swim over to the side. And but I made sure they all were really good swimmers. Some of the fun we had raising the kids, they were some good times and some bad times, but a lot of fun. And one of the things we do is, I'd lay down on the floor like I was a big monster that died, and they were all piled on top of me. And then I'd start to move a arm and a shoulder, and they'd start screaming, "He's coming alive, he's coming alive!" And then I'd race up and throw somebody off, and they'd roll over on the floor, and I'd finally get all of them rolled off on me and chase them around, the monster. One time I was over visiting Kathy and Dan over in the Gettysburg area, and we went downtown to, Georgetown. It was that real pretty fashionable town. We were going down there for dinner, and we couldn't find a parking place. I was up in a garage on the third level or something, and couldn't get a parking place, and there was a handicap open. So I parked at the handicap, and I got out of the car, and I had this limp. I was just practically falling down on the floor, limping. And Kathy and Jane were laughing, screaming. Yeah, that was pretty funny. I only did that once. It was all 8 kids were there, getting their new clothes for the farthest start of school. And they had a setup with some school desks and students standing around the desks and with modeling clothes, and they were mannequins. And we were in Sears, so I went over and I sat in one of the desks, and I put on a stone face, didn't blink or anything, and somebody would walk by and I go and they scream and run away. Some of the funny stuff we had fun doing. And I had a thing once in a while where I'd answer the telephone if it rang, and I'd say, "This is Joe's Bar and Grill. You can whip our cream, but you can't beat our meat." And it was one time it was the nuns, I think, from school. "Oh, yes, sister." Well, talking about shopping in Sears, we went in there one day, and we went through the hardware store, and they had all these toilets on display and up in the wall and everything, and we went on through there, and I turned around and missing somebody, and I looked and I said, "Oh, there's Jim." So I went back to the hardware department, and there's Jimmy. He's just 5 years old and learning how to potty and everything. And he's sitting in a toilet on the floor of the hardware store in Sears, had just taken a big dump And he says, good boy, Jim, are you all through? And he says, yeah, I'm through. And I says, okay. Pulled up his pants and I went up to Jane and I says, we gotta leave. Why? We gotta leave. I'll tell you later. And we gathered up all the kids and left. Got out there, and you can imagine some salesman going up to show this to the customer. Full of poop. Every afternoon during baseball season, we'd spend at least 2 hours out on a baseball diamond. Another guy and I coached, and we were called the Wildcats. And Jim was a pitcher, and Mike was a catcher, and also first base. But anyway, for batting practice, I'd stand up there and throw fastballs for an hour and a half, and just to get him used to seeing the ball and training the catcher so he could catch him and so forth. And I think that's where I did my shoulder. Later in life, I guess 20 years after that, my shoulder started bothering me, and turned out I had arthritis in it. I had arthroscopic surgery on it. It didn't get better, so I finally went to another doctor and did a complete shoulder replacement with a titanium shoulder. And it works pretty good, but it's not perfect. But that was not a lot of fun. But it was fun coaching the kids. Oh yeah, I made desks for all of the kids with my shop smith. And they were, I think I made five of them. I didn't have eight of them, but I shared them, but they had them in their bedroom. And they were pretty good size. They were like a draftsman's table. It was on an angle so they could sit their book on it or their papers, and then had a bottom to it. And then on the side, I had a side box that they could stick their books in when they were finished. And yeah, they were pretty cool. I stained them and varnished them and put them in the bedrooms, and they all used them for years and years. Had all kinds of little writings on them from their ballpoint pens and that weren't on the paper. We had a dog and a cat, Lady BJ and Smokey. It was a Russian blue cat, big, huge cat. He was so neat and polite and everything. He'd go up to the door, the back door, and stretch out real big and put his paws up on the doorknob and wiggle it when he had to go out to potty. Never did anything in the house. And he ruled the neighborhood. But he always came home. We actually got him from the nuns down at the Catholic Church, St. Maria Goretti, and one of the nuns had been raising him, and she got transferred, and so she let us have him. And he was fully trained and everything. He was a really nice cat. I'm not a cat fan, but he was nice. And Lady was, we got her from a pup from the people that raised her, that bred her. And I think it was one of the doctors Jane knew, and we named her Lady BJ, which is Lady Bill and Jane. So that was her full name. And her name was Lady, and she was a great dog. Yeah, we'd howl and she'd sing with us. She was cute. But anyway, we trained Lady to stay down on the bottom floor. We had a two-story house and the bedrooms were all upstairs, and we didn't want her rubbing around, jumping on the beds, I guess. I don't know why we thought that was the best way to do it. And the kids would be racing through the house, chasing each other, and they'd go through the family room and then head up the stairs, flying up the stairs, and she'd be right behind them, and she'd stop right at the bottom of the stairs and watch them go up. Yeah, she was a good dog. I was building a split rail fence, and I was going to get another piece of lumber, and I took the hatchet and I stuck it in the top of the post, and I don't really know how it happened. The next thing I know, the hatchet had fallen off. Mike was on the ground putting dirt around it or something, and the hatchet fell and cut him in the head. It was just a cut. It wasn't didn't go to the skull or anything like that, but did a lot of bleeding. Turned it into a rabbit hutch, didn't we? We bought rabbits for one Easter, and you guys had two big white rabbits, and they had a hutch with food and everything in the, out on the fence. But they were rabbits and they wanted a hole in the ground. So they dug a big hutch under our patio. It's very deep and deep down. And she had a whole litter of bunny rabbits, rabbit babies. And it was winter time, it was cold. She brought them up out of the hutch and she lined them up one right after another in front of our back door. And I picked them up and took them inside. Well, I think five of the six were dead already and frozen. I got one of them, I got him started breathing. I had him on the fireplace and rubbing him and with a fire in the fireplace. And none of them made it. But she had, there was something else. She had them all lined up. They'd get loose and run all over the neighborhood, and the kids would come up and say, "Your rabbit's loose, your rabbit's loose." I said, "If you can catch him, I'll give you a quarter." Nobody could catch those rabbits. They came home when they were hungry, and that's it. They learned scuba diving in Kansas City, so that was while I was in the airline business. I took, in fact, Jane bought me the lessons. And it was about a two-month thing. We had classroom work, and then we went out to a big lake and did our diving. And that was when I started. And, of course, later, and I had trips and passes on the airline, I'd take off and go out and scuba dive, mostly in the Caribbean. And I loved that, those dives, St. Thomas, St. Lucia, and some of the best coral and some of the best fish that had it. Beautiful diving. I went one trip down to Bonaire, which is just off the coast of Argentina. There's three islands down there, the ABC Islands, Aruba, Bonaire, and Curacao. And I stayed on Bonaire and dove every day, twice a day. Our dive master was a big, tall, lanky black man, and of course had a Caribbean accent, and he was just a neat guy. So I'd had my morning dive, and I was laying on the beach, and he came up and he says, "Hey Mac, you want to go feed the moray?" And I said, "Oh yeah." Yeah, I ran up, I got my tank and all my gear, and he says, gave me a bag of chopped up fish. He says, "We go down, feed the moray." So we went out into the water, and then about 200 yards out in the water, it was a wall, and it dropped down to, you don't know, I don't know how deep. We couldn't see the bottom. So we went over the wall and balanced out just down, looking at the front of the wall. And pretty soon, here comes a nose out of the holes in the coral. And more, it was a big old green moray. The teeth, you know, they have this horrible teeth. And so I took a piece of fish out and dropped it, and he snapped it up. And then pretty soon, more. And it should have been in National Geographic, I swear. The two of us were surrounded by moray eels. And we're feeding them out of this little bag. They're diving around. I had one for a little guy, and the other guy would come in and take it from him, and it was beautiful. But in the middle of it, one of the little baby morays went down inside the dive master's jacket, his BC, and because he dropped the fish, and we just, I thought, well, I was just looking, and pretty soon he came out the bottom. And of course we dropped our fish, so we said, "Well, let's go up." And I said, "What'd you think of that, George?" He said, "Not good, not good." The moray was right up against his skin, sliding down inside his jacket. But there were, oh, must have been 100 of them all around us. It was beautiful. Yeah, and I like scuba diving. I did a lot. Did it in Hawaii, in the Mediterranean, or the Caribbean, and Florida. And everybody raves about the diving in Hawaii, and I didn't think it wasn't as good as it was in the Caribbean. Those islands down there are just surrounded by beautiful coral and lots of wildlife. Eventually, my domicile was changed from Kansas City to Denver. I changed it because I had a chance to check out on a Boeing 737, the jet, which is the big airplane, and better than the 580, of course. So I went to Denver and went to school and went to the simulator and so forth and got checked out on the Boeing 737 as a captain. And I commuted from Denver back to Kansas City from one trip to another, and when I finish a trip, jump on an airplane and go back to Kansas City and so forth. And that went on for quite, I think we were 10 years in Kansas City. We had, of course, moved up there from Fort Worth, or Arlington, Texas. And Shannon and Molly and Peggy stayed in Texas when we moved, and I had Mike, Jim, Patty, and Janie in Kansas City. That's where they finished school. And after years and years, it kind of turned out that Jane and I agreed to disagree. And so we did a trial separation, and that wound up in a divorce, unfortunately. So we were divorced in 1985, I think. And so I moved to Denver and packed up a little bit of our furniture from Kansas City, but Jane kept the house and the car and furniture and so forth. And that was, Janie was a senior in high school at that time. So I got a little apartment over in Denver, and in fact, I shared it with another pilot, and we didn't very seldom see each other at the same time. When one guy's on a trip, the other guy's home. And in the process, I met a lady in Denver whom I fell madly in love with, and she did with me too. And her name was Ellen Hanley. And we dated and dated and dated. Eventually, we got married. Ellen had two children. Two girls, Sandy and Linda. And unfortunately, Linda died 2 years ago of cancer. But Sandy still lives in Denver. And she has a son that's just starting college. And AJ, Andrew Joseph. So, Ellen and I began a second life and had a wonderful time. She was pure German, first generation from Germany. All her family was in Germany. So as we went along, we had a lot of vacations we took into Germany and all over Europe, but primarily Germany, at a little city called Ida Oberstein. Her mother and father lived there, and her sister. And we'd go over there every other year, and her mom and dad would come back to Denver for a visit every other year. And we just had a beautiful life and finished, actually got to my 60th birthday and had to retire from Frontier. In the meantime, I had gotten Ellen a job as a flight attendant with Frontier, so we both were flying for Frontier. We had a bad year 1 year. It was 1986, and Frontier went broke, went bankrupt. And so we were both out of a job. I wrote to every airline in the world to try and get back on in flying somewhere, and wasn't having much luck with it because I was already 54 years old. And finally, Frontier's assets and everything got bought by Continental Airlines. And so we're to them, and they picked up what pilots wanted to come over there. And so I started flying for Continental. That's when I retired from Continental, and I was 60 years old. I'd been flying out of Cleveland, Ohio, but I was still living in Denver. So I had a big retirement party back in Denver for my retirement. While I was in the reserves, flying for the airline and flying with the reserves at a naval base in Dallas, I got promoted to lieutenant colonel. And of course, that's what I retired as, a lieutenant colonel. And from the airlines, of course, I retired as a captain. And so that's my famous sights. We planned on doing a lot of traveling and having fun. And the very next year, Ellen came down with cancer of the breast, and she had the whole thing, mastectomy and radiation. And the doctor said, you know, the tradition is if you can make it through 5 years without any more indication of cancer, you've got it made. That's 5 years, the big magic year. So we did, and we were all excited, and I think we had a big party about that too. And 5 years and 6 months later, the cancer came back and went straight to her lungs, and she passed away in a month. So I was already retired, of course, and I was pretty much a vegetable after that. My good friend Tom O'Connor, whom I talked about earlier from college and so forth, called me up. He was living in Phoenix, and he said, why don't you just sell out all that stuff in Denver and come on down here and live with me in Phoenix? He had just gotten divorced. And he said, we could be the dirty old men of Scottsdale. I mean, the grumpy old men of Scottsdale. So I did. I sold everything and moved down to Scottsdale. And I was still very much in remorse and so forth. And Tom started dating a lady out in Fountain Hills. And turns out she had a cousin named Sharon who had just lost her fiance to a medical problem in California and had moved back to Arizona. So they decided we had to meet, and they set us up with a blind date in a place called the Dump? No, what was it called? it was just a bar and a dance floor out in the woods, out north of Scottsdale. But it was a pretty famous place for partying. So that's where we were going to meet, and Tom O'Connor and his date, Sharon's cousin, and Sharon's brother, Dave. And we were all sitting there waiting for Sharon. And Sharon was late, which was pretty much Sharon all the time. And she walked through the gate, and Dave said, now, she's a big girl. She might walk through that gate with an anvil under her arm. I said, thanks, Dave. And she walked through there with a white Western outfit on, with a fringe jacket and everything. Walked across that dance floor, and I said, that is the most beautiful woman I've ever seen. I fell madly in love with her right then. And we started dating. She was living in Fountain Hills, and I was living in Scottsdale. And eventually we decided we're gonna get married, live together for a while, and then we decided to get married. And we did, and bought a house in Scottsdale. And Sharon still was working at a hotel, kind of a part-time job, but we just became an old married retired couple. And lived here. We moved to Gilbert, Arizona, bought a nice home. And 19 years later, Sharon came down with cancer. And had cancer of the liver. It was extremely advanced and fatal. And 6 months later, she was gone. And that's pretty much where I am right now. That's my retirement life. I have a great neighborhood I live in here in Gilbert. Everybody's on a first name basis all up and down the street, both sides of the street. And I joined a bocce club up at the clubhouse where I live. And I was president for 1 year, that was 5 years ago or so, and we expanded the bocce courts. And now I have one of the biggest clubs at the Trilogy housing area. So we got, I do bocce, and then a lot of my neighbors and bocce guys got together with a poker club, and every 2 weeks we get together at a new house every week and play poker, Texas Hold'em. We had a lot of good times with the friends and Sharon. We had neighborhood domino parties and big Christmas parties. And so I'm still trying to adjust to that. But I got my poker buddies and my bocce buddies. Well, of course, I'd love to have dinner with Sharon or Ellen or Jane. But I don't know, just a goofy thought. One of the favorite people I have in the famous world would be Jennifer Lopez. I think she's beautiful and a great singer. I just love to know her. I'd sit down and have dinner. That would be something. When I was in Vietnam, I flew some missions with some army guys and doing reconnaissance up in the jungles. And I flew 26 missions with those guys and a couple of missions in the back seat of the F-4 of the Marines. And so I qualified for an air medal. And but other than that, I just got some medals for being at this place or that place. So one for being on duty at Korea and one for being in Vietnam. And but they're just citations rather than the air medal is the only one that matters to me. That's the most important one I got. So Miley's showing some of my model airplanes of the airplanes I flew in the military and with the airlines. This is a photo F-4 Phantom, and they have the fighter kite and the photo kind. This one has little cameras in it to take pictures instead of rockets and bombs. This is the F-8 Crusader. That's a supersonic fighter plane, single seat, single engine, but with the afterburner, it would go right through the speed of sound up to almost 1.8 speed of sound, almost 2.0 speed of sound. This is my first airplane. Well, it's not my first airplane, but it was the airplane I flew with Frontier Airlines, the 737, which they're still flying today. This was the early model of it. They've got a much better models now, the Dash 737-80 and all that, way up into more seats and more powerful engines, but it's still a two-engine airplane. And this is a DC-9-80. It's an MD-80, which is a 120-passenger airplane. I flew that with Continental. And this is an A-4. It's an attack bomber, single seat, single engine, of course. And that's what the kind of airplanes I liked was just me and the plane. Oh, I look back on my life. Of course, I was a scuba diver. I was a military pilot. I was involved in two wars, Korea and Vietnam. I had a motorcycle, drove a motorcycle. And that's about the highlights of my life. The main highlight is flying airplanes. That was my love from when I was 7 years old and fortunate enough to be able to make a whole career of aviation. And that was a wonderful, wonderful life. I love flying airplanes. Had some real exciting experiences, as I told you about the one in St. Louis. But I don't know, I don't think there's much I would want to do that I haven't done already.
sing, the angels sing the sweetest song I ever heard. You speak and the angels sing, or am I reading music into every word? Suddenly the setting is strange. I can see water and moonlight beaming, silver waves that break on some undiscovered shore. Then suddenly I see it all change. Long winter nights with the candles gleaming, through it all your face that I adore. You smile and the angels sing, and though it's just a gentle murmur at the start, we kiss and the angels sing.